Father, we thank you for the chance to look at your word today, and I pray that you would help us to remember the goodness that comes from the cross. Father, help us to understand what you've done for us when Jesus hung there on that tree. And Father, help us to be connected to your cross so that we can have so many blessings in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so I'm not really going to rush through this because you guys need to get this stuff, okay? But I do want to remind you that what we're doing for the whole year of 2018 is we're looking at evangelism as a larger concept. And what I'm doing this month is sharing some ideas that you might find beneficial when you start sharing with your friends. So if you want to take notes on the back of your bulletin, on that note section, then I would recommend that. That way you can go back and look at these things further. But I want you to pay attention to these things because they're important for your life as a Christian, for how you can share with others. And if you're here today and you're not a Christian, if you haven't been baptized into Christ yet, then there are some things today that hopefully will be impactful to you as well. But we've been talking about good news this month. And last week we talked about perfection, the perfection that we receive in Christ because he lived the perfect life so that we don't have to. This week we're going to talk about redemption. We have been redeemed. That word means we have been bought back. But before we get to the good news, again, I want to remind you what the bad news is. The bad news is that the scripture declares that the whole world is prisoner of sin. The whole world. That includes you. That includes me. That includes the whole world before Jesus. Okay, that's important. Before you have a relationship with Jesus, you're a prisoner to sin. Okay? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Every one of us. We have all sinned. Last week, remember, we all said, I have. Okay? I did. I sinned. And we all recognize that within ourselves. And we know our sin. Our sin, it's always before us, as David has said. And so we know the things that we've done wrong. We know the things that should bring punishment to us. And we don't really want to have to deal with the punishment for our own sin. And in Isaiah, he says, your sins, your iniquities have separated you from God. And so sin has a major consequence between you and God so that there's separation there. You cannot have salvation while you still have sin. You cannot have eternal life while you still have sin. And so we've got to do something about that. And the way we deal with that is through the good news. Now, as we begin to talk about the good news today, I want to go back and give you a picture of what life was like in the Old Testament. Okay, I want you to get this picture in your head of what is known as the Day of Atonement. And the Day of Atonement is still celebrated in the Jewish realm. It's usually in the fall. And on the Day of Atonement in Leviticus, he describes it this way. Then he shall take the two goats and set them before the Lord at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And Aaron shall cast lots over the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for Azazel. And Aaron shall present the goat on which the lot fell for the Lord and use it as a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell for Azazel shall be presented alive before the Lord to make atonement over it, that it may be sent away into the wilderness to Azazel. And you skip forward just a little bit to verse 15, and he says, then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering. So you got the two goats. He shall kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people and bring its blood inside the veil. That's inside the Holy of Holies. And do with its blood as he did with the blood of the bull, sprinkling it over the mercy seat and in front of the mercy seat. So in the Holy of Holies, you have the Ark of the Covenant. The presence of the Lord is on that mercy seat there. And so this is the sacrifice for the sin of all people before the Lord. And then thus he shall make atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the people of Israel and because of their transgressions and all their sins. And so he shall do for the tent of meeting which dwells with them in the midst of their uncleanness. Transgressions and sins are often mentioned in Scripture. Sins are things that we do when we offend what God has planned for us. They're sins against God, okay? Transgressions are sins against one another. And transgressions and sins are both dealt with with these sin offerings. And once a year you have this major event where they make this huge sacrifice for all the people. And you've got the goat that was killed, and the blood is sprinkled on the mercy seat. But what about that goat that's still alive? And Aaron shall lay both his hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the iniquities of the people of Israel, and all their transgressions, all their sins, and he shall put them on the head of the goat, and send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a man who is in readiness. The goat shall bear all their iniquities on itself to a remote area, and he shall let the goat go free in the wilderness. Interesting thing about the old law is you have this Day of Atonement, and in the old law, the Jews, and all the laws of other religions as well, okay? All the old law of the Jews and the old, other religions are like a curse on mankind, for they create a system where mankind can never achieve perfection. Never. Once you have broken one command, you can no longer be perfect again. You are blemished, according to the old law. Sacrifice is always needed to atone for those sins. But one of the things that people don't think about a lot is that the sacrifices for sins in the Old Testament did not take away sin. And that sounds counterintuitive. They're sin offerings, but they don't take away sin. In the book of Hebrews, he describes that the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. And so you have those sacrifices back there, and they send the sins off with that live goat. And the picture here that I want you to get in your mind is every year they send off a live goat with the sins of all the people laid on that goat. And that goat goes off into the wilderness and disappears. Okay? And in around 30 AD, the goats show back up. And they're at the foot of the cross, and all those sins are laid upon Jesus at the cross. You see, when Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just die for all our sins. He died for all the sins for everyone before. Remember that he says in Galatians, the scripture declares that the whole world is a prisoner of sin. He was talking to people that were discussing Judaism and all this kind of stuff. And even in Judaism, the whole world is still in prison to sin without the cross. The cross is vital for our salvation. But if you back up in chapter 3, he says this, "For all who rely on works of the law are under a curse." So that whole Jewish law thing, Levitical law, you're under a curse. "All who rely on any kind of law in order to achieve merit before God are under a curse. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them.' And whoever lived perfectly the old law?" No one did. So everyone is cursed. He continues. "Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law. For the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree,' so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith." Christ bought us by his death on the cross. He bought us away from the legal system of the Jewish way. We don't have to live according to Jewish law anymore. We don't have to worry about earning our place before God anymore, because Jesus redeemed us, bought us from the curse of the old law. Now I want you to turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 9. Okay? Turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 9, and we're gonna read through from Hebrews chapter 9 to chapter 10, verse 18. Okay? I want you to follow along in your Bibles. He begins by saying this, "When Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the goats of the blood of goats and calves," that's the Day of Atonement, "not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood." Now, instead of making the blood sprinkled on the mercy seat, now he's in the Holy of Holies in heaven itself when he died on the cross. And his blood is there making the right atonement. Okay? "Thus securing eternal redemption." If you've been bought by Jesus, no one can ever buy you back. I want you to hear me, church. Sometimes people worry about whether they're going to fall all of a sudden and trip over some sin, and God's going to look down on them without favor. There is a difference between that and rejecting God entirely. Okay? I believe you can reject God entirely and God won't force you to go to heaven. But I don't believe that just because you sinned and you made a mistake that God says you're out. And then you got to wait until you can have an opportunity to pray for forgiveness then, and you're back in again. And this is back in and out and in and out. There's no hope in that. There's no assurance in that. There's no confidence in that. We've been given hope and assurance and confidence in Jesus because we have eternal redemption. Verse 13, for if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant. The old Jewish covenant done away with. He is the mediator of a new covenant. So that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance. Since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. That verse right there, verse 15. What that says is, when Jesus died on the cross, he redeemed, he's not talking about us there, he redeemed everyone for whom sacrifices were made in the old covenant law. All the sacrifices of all the Old Testament were ratified at the cross. It's almost like they were all IOUs and Jesus paid the price at the cross. So the cross redeems everyone in the Old Testament. Okay, that's pretty interesting. It also redeems us. He goes on. For where a will is involved, the death of the one who made it must be established. For a will takes effect only at death, since it is not in force as long as the one who made it is alive. Therefore, not even the first covenant was inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment of the law had been declared by Moses to all the people, he took the blood of calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the covenant that God commanded for you. And in the same way, he sprinkled with blood both the tent and the vessels all used in worship. That picture is when they're consecrating the tabernacle with Moses. Okay, it's the blood of the covenant. Jesus would say, my blood is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you. Okay, verse 22, indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Thus, it was necessary for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these rites, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ has entered not into holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true things, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters the holy places every year with blood not his own. That's the Day of Atonement, year after year after year after year. Jesus doesn't have to do that year after year after year. For then he would have had to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages, to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment, no reincarnation. Sorry to tell you. Some of you are looking forward to it, I know. So Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin. He's already dealt with sin. But to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. For since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come, instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. The old law could never make anyone perfect without the cross. You catch that? Otherwise, they would not have ceased to be offered. Since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins. But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book.' When he said above, 'You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law.' Then he added, 'Behold, I have come to do your will.' He does away with the first, the old law, in order to establish the second, new covenant. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus once for all." Sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus. When Jesus died on the cross, he set us apart. He made us holy by his sacrifice for all time. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which could never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin." We don't make any more sacrifices like the old covenant, because the sacrifice has been made in Jesus. And so what I want us to see this morning is that through the cross, we were set free from the law of works. The Old Testament law, the Jewish covenant, any other legal system that requires you to behave a certain way in order to achieve a particular level of favor with God is dead because of the cross. Every religion in the world, with the exception of Christianity, expects its adherents to live a certain way and do certain things in order to achieve favor with God, whatever their God is called. That, my friends, is called legalism. And when you break the law, you become lawless, you become unrighteous, and you can never again, no matter how much good you do, you can never again undo the bad that you've done. No matter how many sacrifices, for the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. But through Christ, we've been set free from that legal system. Also through the cross, we were totally cleansed of sins. Totally. Totally. It doesn't mean that we're not going to sin again. It just means that we don't have to worry about it anymore. We don't have to be concerned about our sinfulness in front of God. That's part of what we talked about last week. God traded Jesus' perfection for our imperfection. And through the cross, that was ratified. That sacrifice takes away our sins eternally. But I want to remind you what it says back in Galatians. "But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons." Not only were we set free from the law, not only were we totally cleansed from sin, but we were adopted as sons and daughters of God. Now, I want you to get this picture in your head too, okay? A lot of times when you adopt people today, you sign papers of adoption, but you don't get a new birth certificate. Okay? In the old days, back when Jesus was there, when you got adopted, they would take your birth record and wipe it out and write a new birth record. So that when somebody came to see what your records were, all they could see was your current family. Your other family was done away with. So when God adopted you, then there is no longer evidence that Satan ever owned you? None. He wiped away that record and made a new record with you being a son or a daughter of God. So we were adopted. We're set free. We're cleansed. Church, if you're not redeemed from the law, you're responsible for your sins. How many of you want to be responsible for your sins? Not a wise decision, because the wages of sin is death. If you're not adopted, you do not yet belong to God's family. You get that, right? So the question is, how do I get redeemed, totally cleansed, adopted? How can I connect to the cross of Jesus? I'm going to share one passage of Scripture with you, and then I'll be done. Romans 6, he says this. Oh, sorry, two passages of Scripture. Galatians 2, he says, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. He doesn't say, the life I live in the flesh, I live by the righteousness attained through the law. He doesn't say that. The righteous live by faith. And so through the crucifixion of Jesus, through being crucified with Christ, we're made right with God. But how are you crucified with Christ? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Baptism is a form of reenacting the death of Christ. If you want to be connected with Christ, to be set free from the law that leads to death, to be totally cleansed of your sins, to be adopted as a son or daughter of God, to be a part of the family of God globally, and you need to be connected to the cross through baptism into Christ. Amen. Baptism connects us to the death of Jesus. And the death of Jesus redeems us from all that separates us from God. He buys us back from the prison that we were in when we were slaves to sin. So have you been set free? Have you been cleansed? Are you a part of the family of God? Have you been baptized into Christ? If you have, then recognize that the majority of the people outside these doors have not. And they need this good news too, that this is offered for them as well. And who's going to tell them but us? So we have a lot of work to do. But if you haven't been baptized into Christ, then I encourage you to make the decision to do that. If you want to know more information about it, come talk to me. Let me know. You want to know more? We'll study. We'll look into it. But don't put it off. I did a funeral yesterday for a 37-year-old woman. She wasn't expecting to die at 37. We don't know how tomorrow's going to be. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your redemption through the cross. We thank you for our adoption as sons and daughters. We thank you for our forgiveness of sins. We thank you, Father, that we don't have to earn your salvation. We don't have to earn your favor, for you love us unconditionally. And you see us as perfect through Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection. Help us to be ambassadors of the cross of Christ, sharing with others the hope that comes through Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.